Hello everyone, it's your host, James Hansen, and with me today, I have my beautiful, wonderful, intelligent, buff, tall, amazing friend, Seth the Programmer, and we are going to be talking about kind of just our general thoughts on the Bankai of Aizen Sosuke, what we think about it, and some certain things about Aizen's character a little bit interesting. This video will seem a little bit not coordinated, maybe, but it's still has really interesting information, I think. And there's a lot of cool things to discuss. So it's a little bit more of a podcast-y style of video, maybe, but it should be short, brief, and you guys will enjoy it. So without further ado, let's let the programmer give his thoughts.
That was beautiful. Like, I really liked that intro. Like, he really snapped off the tongue, you know?
Honestly, like, yeah, I think I popped off there. Like, that deserves a like on the video.
Yeah, I think that does. Maybe a subscribe, maybe? To both
some good
channels,
improv.
Maybe.
Yeah.
So upon our discussion with Sosuke Aizen and many other things, actually, we kind of just went into this conversation about Aizen's Bankai, and as well as Seth just said, his character, right? And a really interesting panel that really struck to me was Aizen talking about how each Soul Reaper has like a limit to how much they can master, right? And then beyond that point, you know, it's very little improvement or evolution over time. To which Seth then rightly said, can he even do the things that he wants to do in the first place? Like, does he believe that he's even reached the limits, or is that just plain ignorance? And do you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
Let's elaborate first on what Aizen's Bankai would be a little bit generically, based on like normal characteristics that you see among him, or, you know, maybe more generic comments you see even in the fandom about what his Bankai should be. And then I'll kind of elaborate a little bit why it should probably be a little bit different, I think. And I think that'd be a little bit more constructive.
Sure. If you want a more generic response to this, is more like every Shikai and Bankai has, of course, the same trait and fixated around the same sense of realm that ability is entangled with. So I've always believed in the sense of it goes beyond, obviously, the five senses, which, you know, I've spoken about in previous videos, but it kind of gives, you know, a sense of like difference in, you know, gravity or balance, or even little things such as blood pressure, the senses of the body and the senses of your surrounding area. And I don't really know how that would be convenient in battle, if I'm completely honest with you, hence why I'm not really sold on it myself. But I can't really think of a way that you can really extend the sense of sense unless you do the opposite of sense, which, you know, is a bit of a convoluted conversation in and of itself. So I don't really know what it would be in that term of hypnosis.
Maybe it could just be straight up mind control or puppeteering, even like maybe like some Kodo Amatsukami from Naruto kind of thing, where you're being controlled without even knowing it, rather than you're seeing things. Perhaps maybe it's actually like making you believe those things instead.
Well, you could do something like the Izanagi from Naruto, right? Where,
yeah,
like it makes the person keep reliving their own little reality until they've come to some sort of realization, maybe. I'm not quite sure, you know. The possibilities are, in fact, endless, but very limited at the same time.
That and some generic 5 through 10 times multiplier of power or whatever is basically what most people say about his Bankai. But I don't think his Bankai actually would be that.
Okay.
And I think that for a certain reason. So the thing about Aizen that's pretty interesting is that he doesn't seem to fully understand himself like that well at all. He's a very conflicted character. And we see, in fact, when characters are conflicted, their Zanpakutos will start teasing and bullying them, basically, and making fun of them or hiding things from them because they don't think they're worthy or they don't know their true selves. Because at the end of the day, the Zanpakuto is a representation of your spirit. Your spirit is infusing into the blade, and then it becomes who you are over time. That's why the older you are, the more developed your Zanpakuto is, kind of like, you know, aging like wine. You know, that's why Yamamoto's Zanpakuto is so extravagant and powerful, because he's just sat there for 2,000 years with his sword, dedicating himself to it and absorbing into it.
Exactly. Do you want to give an example of a Zanpakuto that does this?
Yeah, so a good example of a Zanpakuto that does in fact represent the person's soul is Soifan's Bankai. and Shikai in Zanpakuto. So Soy Fawn's Zanpakuto is the ultimate example because the Shikai represents something more on the surface, something that you would think consciously.
Mm-hmm.
So Soy Fawn on the surface and consciously, she wants to believe that she is this assassin. You know, she wants to believe she is this ultimate killer that can, you know, two-tap her opponents. She is a worthy heir to Yoruichi's assassination division, right? Her true self is someone more bombastic and more energetic and passionate. You see those passions in the Yoruichi fight when she just starts breaking down in tears, you know, freaking out like, why did you bring me with you and stuff like that. This stoic assassin lady is breaking down like that.
Almost like, I want attention, right? Like, yeah. Here's this big-ass bazooka and here's me wanting your attention. You give it me, right?
Exactly. And that's one of the things I loved about Bleach is that the Zanpakuto was such an interesting way to show who a person truly was. And this is the same with pretty much every character that truly does understand themselves. You'll see their Bankais are extensions of that. So Shunsui is bad with women and bad with the games they play. And, you know, there's all this crazy amounts of lore with them.
Aren't we all, though?
Yeah.
Aren't we
all? And so his Zanpakuto is a woman that plays games with him and he has to learn how to play the game properly and stuff like that. And I imagine that Yamamoto's is that in deep inside, he has a really deep-seated flames of passion and hatred and anger and all these things. And that's why he was so powerful and frenzied when it came to the Quincy War, because he was unleashing that. He was barbaric. He was a criminal. And then we see that those powers are still dwelling within him. And while people think, oh, the flames within him are like dying down, he's actually been penting them up over his lost comrades and all that. And that's why he developed abilities where he could like literally revive Yuha's dead friends to rub them in his face and things like that. But we see that anger within him when his friend is killed by the Stern Ritter, and then it's unleashed in his Bankai. So it's still an extension of him.
Which is a great point as well, because you also see Yamamoto with like the most abilities in terms of like everyone else's Bankai usage. Yeah, Toshiro has some, he's a bit of a prodigy, and he does meditate. We've seen this many times. And obviously Byakuya too, like he has good use of his sword and his Bankai as well. But when it comes to many different elements of other Soul Reapers, like they're still novices when it comes to their Shikai and Bankai abilities, and they haven't fully utilized its sheer power yet, right? So that's why you see Yamamoto use many different elements and many different key factors, whether that's defense, offense, precision.
There's another good example, because his Shikai and even his Bankai at first, it seems like his true form is he likes to keep people at a distance. Like, he almost creates a wall of blades that prevents anybody from getting close to him.
Oh yeah, the safe zone.
But the true form of his Bankai is he wields one sword in front of his opponent, and then he has a very passionate battle to the death with that opponent with that one blade, basically. And that was his true self when he opens up to people. And that's kind of why he opens up to Ichigo and considers him, like, rival-ish. And,
love that analogy, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
But with Aizen, to say that, and this goes into the fact that Aizen thinks he is the ultimate powerhouse, that you can't grow stronger as a Shinigami, there's a limit, but do we know if Shinigami really just reach a limit with their Zanpakuto? Because that never seems implied. The reason it doesn't seem implied is because even if you were to say in a boxing match that they put boxing gloves on, that Aizen would outbox Yamamoto somehow, which we don't know. It seems to be contradicted by the guides, but if you did, Yamamoto's sword is still way stronger than Aizen's. This is stated. He has the strongest Zanpakuto. It's not just the strongest fire type. It is the strongest ultimate Zanpakuto in general, like all around, universally the best Zanpakuto. And this is because he's honed it even more since Yuha's fight. So if the Zanpakuto just eternally seems to grow until Yamamoto's so old he's about to die of old age, and Aizen's Zanpakuto is not that level, then Aizen hasn't reached his limits as a Soul Reaper, because his Zanpakuto has not reached its peak. It just objectively hasn't until it reaches at least above Yamamoto's level or Yamamoto's Zanpakuto's level. So it would be stated that Aizen's Zanpakuto would be equal to Yamamoto's if there was a limit, right? But it's not. It's just directly inferior, implying that Yamamoto either surpassed the limits of Shinigami. I don't know. Did he take a hollow pill? Like, how did he do it, Aizen? It's because Aizen's Bankai never truly revealed itself to him.
Like Zabimaru did with Renji, right?
It's exactly.
Like, you weren't ready, or you didn't accept me, or you were too ignorant. You know, it's like,
yes.
Yeah, I'm not going to give you my full ability. And it could be exactly the same with Aizen, as you just yes. implied, which made a really interesting fact when you said, hey, maybe that's why he's still stuck in the Mukan.
Yes, because one thing about Aizen is if he has a contradictory nature, one where he wants to be a god, an ambitious god above all, in terms of power, in terms of ruling, and he wants to be like what Yuha is, basically. Like, he wants that status, but he wants to then take the Soul King and finish the job, blah, blah, blah. He wants to be what Yuha does. And then the other side of him's like, well, at the same time, I kind of wish I could have just done, like, a Byakuya versus Ichigo moment, like, on the Sokyoku Hill. And it's like, what? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, are you hoping there's going to be other Soul Kings out there for you to fight? It's just because his own nature is fighting against himself. One wants to be the strongest, and one wants a good battle at the same time. Or wants equals, or rivals, or things that can make him lesser. So, this contradiction within him is what keeps his true Bankai from ever showing. So, Aizen's Bankai would never fully grow, and so he's like, oh, I hit my limit, that's it. It's because his Bankai is not developing anymore, because he's not understanding himself any better. And so, if Aizen were to be defeated, and then his soul is resonating through Ichigo to the point Ichigo's like, yeah, I could feel what he felt, and it seems like
he's crying out in loneliness.
It seems like he low-key wanted me to kind of punch him in the mouth a little bit. So, if Aizen's realizing that in that battle, you know, he's having like his perfect Cell Frieza freak-out moment on the surface, but deep down, he's like, is this kind of what I wanted? Like, you know... That's why he
doesn't seem as fulfilling as I thought it would. You know?
Yeah, that's why he sits in the Mukan. He could probably escape. He could have escaped the second they let him out and tried to fight Yuha. He could have just gotten away. What would they have done? They couldn't have stopped him. He would have just Kyoka'd and just got away. No, like, there's really nothing. They're not strong enough to do anything. Maybe Ichigo's strong enough, but even then, we don't know how Kyoka would affect Ichigo. Would he just have to look at Aizen's general body and get hit by it now? Does it even, like, have to be unsheathed? You know, things like that. So, Aizen wants to be in the Mukan for that exact reason. Because he's like, wait a minute. I really didn't understand myself as much as I thought. And they're like, yeah, you're stuck in here for 20,000 years. And he's probably like, good. Time for some self-reflection.
It almost seems like that's the case, because in the last chapter where he's talking about the courage of, like, you know, Ichigo and Rukia towards those last ending dialogues, it does seem like he is thinking more on an emotional level, and he is reflecting a lot on the past and how humans are. And
yeah.
I feel like he's getting a sense of empathy in that regard. So, yeah, I would definitely say it holds weight to say that he is in the Mukan, just reflecting and thinking and kind of trying to find out more about himself, doing some mental gymnastics on different fighting styles and how to, you know, how he would break out and what he wants to do once he gets out. There's many different variables. So can he? I would say he can do Bankai.
Definitely.
Is it to his liking was another question we both had.
And maybe after the Mukan, it's probably better. Maybe that's also why he also grew stronger. He might have also grown stronger, not just because of the Hogyoku, but because he started understanding himself. And self-understanding in Bleach gives you amps. So
yep.
That might be an example of why he got stronger and so on. But I just wanted to break this down for you guys. You have Sosuke Aizen, who's basically, on the surface, he's doing the sociopath American, you know, psychopath, you know, smiles, killing Momo, his 20-year attendant, and doing these crazy things, cutting down captains, murdering people, toying with them, testing on them, blah, blah, blah. And then at the same time, we learn in the novels that he has somewhat of a stoic and respected side, where he's like, yeah, I actually killed Tosin because I promised him I would. And it's like, wait, this sociopath...
Out of relief, yeah.
Yeah, this sociopath granted him that? Really? And there's even this argument that this sociopath is respectful to people like Coyote Stark and Haribel because he actually agrees with what their values. And some would even argue that he spares Haribel. Like, he could have probably chopped her in two in one hit, but it seems like he just kind of spared her almost. It seems that deep down he has these conflicting stoicisms and respects for courage and livelihoods that people have that he's trying to kind of mask. So that's why, in my opinion, his Bankai, even if he did show it in the Soul Society, would never have been his true Bankai. So hopefully we actually could see it in the future of Bleach.
Maybe that's something for the Hell arc, you know, something completely new and fresh.
Yeah,
which,
yeah.
You know, would make sense because, you know, the Hell is diverged of, you know, the Soul Society, where Commander, those realms, it's its own thing. And the fact that what was stated in the last chapter, that Aizen himself was, well, and you watch, I suppose you could classify, was also keeping those gates closed.
Yes.
Now that they're open, it's like, you know, you're going to need something stronger than those exactly. two now. So that amp, that 10 times amp, might actually be very useful.
Yeah.
To say the least.
For sure.
So, yeah, again, you pose an interesting question. Many people would like to know what Aizen's Bankai does. Does he have it? Yes, he does have it, because he can hypnotize people without saying the name, such as how Renji can use Zabimaru without shouting out its name, and you know, Byakuya notices in the Soul Society arc. It's like, how did you do that? Did you learn Bankai? When you can use a move in Shikai without calling its name, yeah, that's kind of a necessity. It's kind of a requirement. So yes, he can use it, but does he want to? Clearly not. And I think Seth brought some really good points to the table about, you know, would it even be good? Is he even happy with it?
Right.
And is there room for improvement? So I think this would be
pretty good. Curious what you guys in the comments think. What do you think his true Bankai would be? Because remember, that hypnosis, the manipulation, that Machiavellian, you know, attitude might be his surface level Shikai-esque like abilities.
So yeah, he's trying to mask himself in front of other people, right?
Yes. So you need to look deep down. What do you think Aizen's true self would be represented with in terms of a sword? And that's all I have to say. Thank you for having me on the channel. It was a cool discussion. And yeah.
With that being said, I'm going to catch you motherfuckers later. Please go check out Seth's channel in the description down below. And as always, people, peace out.
Bye-bye.